Well, welcome back. And I guess before we go any further, let me just state that if for some reason we do experience a power outage like we did right before the break, everybody please remain calm and remain in your seats. And we'll see what the situation is. And if we need to file out of the room, we'll let you know. And if for some reason that there is a point that we need to adjust the schedule, we will have everybody on our group text message to make sure that everybody's well aware of what the timeline is for the day. But that's just hopefully something we don't have to deal with. But more than anything, I want you to understand that this next session is something that I've really personally been looking forward to. Rohit Bhargava is a trend curator who helps brands and leaders win by learning to see what others miss. He is the Wall Street Journal best-selling author of 5 books on topics from the future of business to building a brand with personality to why leaders always eat left-handed. And his signature book, Non-Obvious, features 15 annual trend predictions and has been read or shared by over 1 million readers in its 8th year of publication. Rohit is the founder and chief trend curator of the Non-Obvious company and previously spent over 15 years leading digital and innovation strategy for global brands at Leo Burnett and Ogilvy. He is the founder of 3 successful companies, advises multiple startups, and teaches storytelling at Georgetown University in Washington, D.C. His thinking has been featured on NPR, Fast Company, and the Harvard Business Review, and he writes a column for GQ magazine in Brazil. Today, he'll share his insights on how to be trusted in a skeptical world. Please join me in welcoming Rohit Bhargava.
That's inappropriate walk-on music, huh? Soak up the sun. But I gotta say, this gift that you guys got of the towel, I mean, what kind of epic planning is that, right? Considering the weather outside. So I wanted to tell you a little story, and the story is of me being 17 years old and deciding for sure what I wanted to do in my life. And I made the mistake of telling it to my dad, because what I wanted to do was be a playwright. And I told my dad, and I don't think that was the future he imagined for me, because his first response after that was, you know, I was reading about this engineering camp that I think you should go to, and it'll be great for the summer. And so, you know, I liked science, even though I wanted to be a writer. And so I told my dad, I said, okay, I'll go. And this engineering camp was at the Rose Holman Institute of Technology. And the first day I showed up there, I don't know if you've ever had a moment like this, where you show up in a room and you know you're in the wrong room. You know you don't belong. And that was me showing up at engineering camp, because all of these other kids, and there were 100 boys, it was an all-boy camp, all of these other kids knew exactly what they were talking about when it came to all of these highly technical things. And I realized right away that I wasn't gonna be very happy in this camp, but I was stuck there for 3 weeks, and it was like a sleepaway camp, so I was gone. You know, I was gonna be there. So I got assigned to a group, because that's how they did it. They put us into groups. And my group immediately figured out that I wasn't gonna be useful too. So they decided they didn't need me. In fact, being direct 17-year-old boys, they were like, we don't need you. They told me, okay? So this was good, because the first day I realized I wasn't necessary. I was unnecessary. So I had a choice. What was I gonna do? Now this was, you know, maybe 20 years ago, so we didn't have Netflix, or I couldn't like binge watch a show or anything like that. I had to figure out what to do. So I decided that I was gonna become the cruise director of this camp. I was gonna organize ultimate frisbee competitions. I was gonna create open mic nights. We did poker. We had all sorts of fun, and I was the fun creator, because I had nothing else to do, right? My group was working on their project. All the groups were working on their projects, and I was just having fun. So the last day of camp rolls up, and we all present our projects. And I stood kind of behind my group, pretending like I'd done something, when actually I hadn't. And at the end of that whole thing, they had a couple of individual awards. And one of the individual awards they had was something called the Good Citizen Award. And the Good Citizen Award was voted on by your fellow 100 peers. Now, because all of these boys were sort of introverted, they're highly technical, and they all went into their groups, they didn't know that many people outside of their own group, except the cruise director. Everyone knew him. So I got the most votes and I won this award, the Good Citizen Award, and I was so excited. And I got back home and I told my dad this camp was amazing because I got the Good Citizen Award. And he said, so you're gonna be an engineer? And I said, no. But I told someone that story a couple months later and they said, so you went to camp for 17-year-old engineering students and you won Miss Congeniality. I'm like, yeah, I guess I kind of did win Miss Congeniality, but what it taught me about myself was something very interesting. And it was that I understood people much more than I understood technology. And so I decided that day at Rose Holman Institute that I was gonna do something related to people, which is a pretty awesome thing to realize at 17 years old. Now, I also knew that I wasn't the natural entrepreneur. I wasn't the kid who had the lemonade stand. That wasn't me. But I did want to start something. So my first business that I decided to start in 1999 was what I thought would be a brilliant idea, which is a website that would help people find restaurants. That's what it looked like. Now, if you look at it today, not too nice, but back then, this was a pretty cool website. And the idea was, let me list all the restaurants, and then I'll go to the restaurants and I'll say, let me build you a website, because in 1999, most restaurants didn't have websites. So I said, let me build you a website, and then you can market to people online. And I went door to door to restaurants, and I said, I will build you a website for $200. And I couldn't convince a single restaurant to build a website, because every restaurant owner looked at me and said, why would I need a website? But I wasn't ready to give up on the idea yet. So I went to one restaurant, Miss Saigon Thai, Vietnamese restaurant in DC, and I said, I'll build your website for free, just so I can pretend like someone paid me and I might be able to get some other restaurants to go on board. And even that didn't work. So eventually, I had to give up on the idea, and I realized much later in life what my problem was. And it wasn't that the idea was ahead of its time, it's that I didn't have the right relationships with anyone. I was a random dude walking in off the street selling something nobody wanted. I didn't even have a great product. Over the course of my career, I realized that there are some things that we believe we need in order to be able to be successful. And so I started focusing on those things, and then I realized that maybe it doesn't set us up for success. And I led myself to three scary facts, and I want to share those scary facts with you because it sets up the topic for what I'm going to talk about, which is trust. And I'm going to make your note-taking, if you're a note-taker, very, very easy, because there's going to be one slide at the end that'll sum up my whole presentation. And as you'll see through my style, I tend to use a lot of images. So I don't really have bullet points. I'm going to flow through lots of images very, very quickly. I'm going to tell you a couple stories. And the first story I want to tell you is of a guy named Christopher Latham Schulz, who invented the typewriter. And when he invented the typewriter, he had a user problem. His user problem was people started using it, and they loved it, and they got too good at it. And when they got too good at it and they typed too fast, those keys that would hit the paper would move too fast and they would get stuck. And he didn't know how to make the typewriter work faster. So the only solution he could think of is that he had to make people type slower. So he redesigned the keyboard. He made it suboptimal. He forced people to use their pinkies. He moved the vowels further out. He redesigned the keyboard so that people had to type slower. And his redesigned keyboard is the QWERTY keyboard, the keyboard we all use today. If you've ever wondered why the letters are in that order, it's because someone 100 years ago said, I need people to type slower. Raise your hand if you'd like to type slower. Nobody, right? So of course, someone comes along 50 years later, Augustus Dvorak, and he says, I can fix this problem. Because people don't want to type slower, they want to type faster. And he redesigns the keyboard, and he names it humbly after himself, the Dvorak keyboard. And he puts all the vowels on the middle row, and he makes it much faster. But he realizes he won't be able to convince anyone to use it just like that. He has to prove that it's better. So remember, this is the 1950s. So he goes and he finds a professional typist named Barbara Blackburn. And Barbara Blackburn learns how to use the Dvorak keyboard. And then she enters into a typing competition, which they had because it's the 1950s. And she wins with a top speed of over 200 words a minute on the Dvorak keyboard. So Augustus Dvorak, a professor who redesigns the keyboard, proves that his keyboard is faster. Now raise your hand if you use a Dvorak keyboard. Why not? We all want to type faster. We all want to be more productive. We know the keyboard design that we're using now you know, is suboptimal. So why wouldn't you use the new one? The problem is, having the best product isn't always enough. Because we have habits. We have things that we're used to doing. We have traditions. We have best practices, right? Best practices, which we think are the best. And when someone comes along and says, hey, this is better, we don't always believe it, even if they quantifiably show it to be true. And that's the first scary fact, because everyone tells you, right? Have the best product. I mean, that's what the certification is about, that you have the best product. And I'm not saying don't have a better product. Of course you want to have a better product. But we have to do more than just that. That's not enough. The second scary fact comes down to a story from thousands of years ago of Middle Eastern traders who would go to the spice markets and sell one spice at a premium above everything else. One spice that people would pay extra for. And the reason they would pay extra for this spice is because the way they would harvest it would be by fighting this bird, this mythological bird that was told of in many ancient texts that looked like this and that lived in these crazy nests. And in order to get these sticks that this bird made its nest out of, they had to heroically go up to the bird and knock it out of the nest and then go and harvest the sticks, and then they'd bring them to the market. So of course, this product was more expensive, right? Of course that spice was a premium, because look at all the work they had to do to get it. Now these were the sticks, cinnamon sticks. And it turned out, over time, people figured out that that's not actually true. That was entirely made up. It was entirely made up so they could charge a premium for cinnamon. Now, in marketing, we call that storytelling. Hopefully it's based on truth, sometimes it's not. But having the best story sometimes isn't enough either. Because when we tell a story, people don't always buy it. And sometimes it's not even based on total truth. It should be, but it's not always. So that's the second scary fact. And the third scary fact is that we believe if we can make people happy, that will lead to more people being happy. And this great book by a friend of mine says, satisfied customers tell 3 friends and angry customers tell 3,000. And we see this online, right? And what we hope is that our satisfied customers will be our best advertising, because they'll rave about how much they love us. They'll tell everyone. And the flaw in that logic is satisfied customers are happy today, but not always happy. And they might be looking around around the corner or over their shoulder to see what else is coming next. Because satisfaction isn't the same thing as delight. Customer satisfaction, think about the word satisfaction. I'm satisfied. That means I went in, I bought something, you gave me what I expected, and I walked out. Is that a transformative experience? Is that delight? No. I'm satisfied. It's good. Can someone else satisfy me? Sure. Can they do it for slightly cheaper? Yeah. Can I have a slightly better experience with them? Sure, then I'll switch. That's what happens. But think about your cell phone plan, right? All of cell phone marketing is based on that. Do you really care who your cell phone provider is? Hey, you want a new phone, right? They have you stuck in a contract. We'll buy out your contract and give you a brand new phone. That's what they all do. That's their entire marketing, because they know that even though you're satisfied, you'll switch. So if these 3 things that we're often told, satisfied customers, great product, great stories, if those things don't matter, what do we do now? Do we panic? I mean, I'm trained in marketing and I'm panicking, because all these things that used to matter don't matter as much. And the underlying truth behind why they don't matter is because we have to focus on something else. We have to focus on one thing. And the one thing is trust. How do we build trust? How do we get trust? How do we retain trust from the people that we're selling to, from the people who are working for us, from the relationships we've got with everyone else? How do we do that? Because if we could do that, then our customers would be more than satisfied. They would love our product, but stay with our product. They would stick with us. They would believe our story. So we have to be able to build trust. Now, part of the reason that trust is such a tentpole and so difficult at the same time is because we all share the same problem. We're living this problem every day. And the problem is that we're in the middle of a believability crisis. Everything's fake. There's fake news, there's fake products, there's fake people, there's fake leaders, there's fake everything. And so we don't know what to trust. And I think if we're gonna understand the believability crisis, we have to go backwards in time a little bit. to understand why it is. This is what we used to do with marketing. More doctors smoke Camels than any other cigarette. Therefore, it must be good for you, right? Because if the docs are smoking, they know something we don't know, right? So you don't have to worry. Warning, this image has been retouched to lower your self-esteem. Because so much of fashion advertising and what we see in the media doesn't make us feel good about ourselves, right? Here's a real ad from Levi's that says, hotness comes in all shapes and sizes. Now, I'm not an expert, but those four women look approximately the same size to me. So according to Levi's, hotness comes in four shapes and sizes that are pretty much the same size. This product says, all natural, helps boost your child's immunity. How is it possible that this could be all natural? Have you ever seen a tree that grows Cocoa Krispies out in the wilderness? No. So how is it possible that this could be all natural? Does that make sense? Right? Maybe if we just tell people it's not advertising, right? This is an ad that says, this is not an ad. And then underneath in small print, it says, this is a reminder to buy someone you love a PlayStation. Shh, it's not an ad. But it is an ad. But maybe if we pretend like it's not an ad, then people will buy it. Is Evian actually bottled in the Swiss Alps, or is it just naive spelled backwards? Is this Jersey water? Do we know? Is there a flavor difference? Can we tell? Yes, I'm sorry to be the one to tell you, but these are actually Cheerios. There is no such thing as a donut seed. That doesn't exist. And rebranding it that way isn't going to make it exist. Now, maybe if we just told people that we're false advertising, because it's all kind of a joke anyway, right? So if we just admitted it, then maybe people would buy in. Maybe they would trust a little bit more. But what they think is that all of this marketing is selling us toxic sludge, selling us something that isn't going to make us better or healthier or happier. It's taking advantage of us. That's what people think a lot of times. Now, media doesn't help, because what do we see in the media? We see all these miracle cures, a miracle pill that will help you with any problem that you have in your entire life. There's a healthcare solution to that problem. This was a real story. Chemical in McDonald's fries could cure baldness. Huh, let me run out and get some fries right now. I'd love to have more hair on my head. If McDonald's fries can do it, I'll just go and get those. Here's another story. Study finds average American inadvertently eats equivalent of 8 pieces of fruit a year. Now, this was not a real study. This is a satirical website called The Onion, but it may as well be real. Can we tell the difference between this and the McDonald's chemical that cures baldness? Is there much of a difference? No one knows. Maybe if we just had more pictures of Abraham Lincoln, stuff would be more believable, right? If we just put a picture of someone authoritative and then put the quote up, then people buy it and they share it. That's a meme, right? Then we can take advantage of it. Then people will buy into it. But the problem that this creates is that the practice of selling anything is harder today than it's ever been in the past. And this is not a challenge that's reduced to one industry or one group. No, this is the challenge that all of us face, because this stuff, these articles, these pieces of marketing, that's what someone sees right before they walk into that meeting with you. That's what they're trying to avoid. That's what they're being influenced by. And that same person is about to get into that meeting. That same consumer is about to walk into your store. So this problem affects you, it affects us. It's a big, big challenge. How do we create trust? How do we be more trusted? So I believe being more trusted comes down to 5 things. And at the end, I'll give you one slide that'll have all 5 things, so you can choose to take notes throughout. You can do what I see some very, very smart people doing throughout this presentation, which is using that device you have in your pocket to just take photos. Because don't you hate it when someone puts up a couple bullets and you're like, oh, I was only on bullet 2, and then they move on, right? Take the phone, snap the picture. You got all the bullets, right? It's a great way to take notes. Great way to take notes. So good on you for those people who are already doing that, right? So let's talk about building trust. The first principle is we have to embrace the cold, hard, dirty, beautiful truth. What's the truth? What's actually happening? And how do we embrace it, even if it doesn't necessarily feel like we should? Well, we do it in an unusual way. The Hansbrinker Budget Hotel is a budget hotel in Amsterdam that's been proudly disappointing travelers for 40 years, boasting levels of comfort comparable to a minimum security prison. They send people to the train station in Amsterdam to say, please don't stay at the Hansbrinker Budget Hotel. It will be awful. You don't want to stay there. Classic reverse psychology, right? You don't want to stay there. Their marketing apologizes in advance for all the things they'll screw up, such as losing your luggage, ignoring your complaints. They have posters that they put up all over talking about how bad this experience is going to be. They promise that if you stay there, your immune system will improve because it's so dirty. The only possible bodily response would be to get healthier because it's so dirty. So your body will fight back with antigens if you stayed there. They give you cardboard cutouts for all the things that are not included, such as combs, telephones, hair dryers. Their games room is a post-it note. So you better be ready to like get creative if you're going to stay at the Hans Brinker budget hotel. They have asterisks next to all the things that are not included in their experience, such as maid service, linens, windows, towels. They're ranked directly below an abandoned mineshaft in terms of desirable places to stay in Amsterdam on the official list. And if all of this marketing wasn't enough to make you want to stay there the next time you go to Amsterdam, their bold brand promise is it can't get any worse, but we'll do our best. Now, this is not a fictional place. It's not a made-up place. It's a real hotel. This is real marketing. And they're always packed, always full. People can't wait to stay there. How is that possible? Why would anyone want to go anywhere and have a suboptimal experience? Well, it turns out their audience are young people, generally, who are backpacking through Europe, who don't have a lot of money. They're staying at budget accommodations and hostels. And what those young people want, more than anything else, is an experience they can share with their friends and post on Instagram and post on Snapchat and share with everyone. And what better experience than to say that you stayed at the world's worst hotel that made you healthier because of how dirty it was, and you survived. And so, of course, that's what people want to do. And by the way, when they get to this hotel, and they actually get to the room where they have a bed and a sheet and a pillow and nothing else, people are like, this place is amazing! Because they set the expectations so low that anything they do that doesn't basically involve slapping you in the face when you walk in the door will be an upgrade, right? And so they win. Can you think how many other hotels are competing with them to be the worst? No one. So they own their space. That's positioning, right? That's how positioning works in marketing. Now, usually, people don't try and position themselves as the worst. But for them, it's a creative way of saying, look, we're not offering luxury. We're basic. We're a hostel, right? We never were offering luxury. That's not what we do. What we do is we give you an experience you can talk about. And by giving you an experience you can talk about, people want to stay there. And it works. So well that they have a second one in Lisbon. They're expanding because it's working. This is one of my favorite products, the Hutzler 571 Banana Slicer, which has well over 5,000 reviews on Amazon and is one of the best-selling kitchen appliances on the site all the time. It has so many reviews that there are discussions happening about this product. And yes, it's not like a trick. It's exactly what it sounds like. It's a banana slicer. And the discussions about this product go like something like this. Does this work on Brazilian bananas better than ones from Italy? To which someone responds, yes, I'd be happy to help. Are we talking about Tuscany bananas or Neapolitan bananas? Be specific. Otherwise, how can I answer that question? How long did it take to get? All sorts of discussions. The number one most helpful five-star review for this product starts, this banana slicer saved my marriage. And it goes on and talks about all the ways that the morning routine has been transformed. But not everyone loves it. The most helpful one-star review is from someone who very angrily posts in all caps, this banana slicer does not work! Exclamation point, exclamation point, exclamation point. And underneath it says, all of my bananas curve the opposite direction. If you haven't figured out the gag by now, people are trying to outdo each other with these comments. It's become a competition of ridiculousness. Who can be the most ridiculous? Who can write the craziest review and get the most people to like it? And by the way, all of that crazy commentary is selling banana slicers. And the maker of this banana slicer is laughing all the way to the bank. Because guess what? It is a ridiculous product, and they do make it. And instead of being sensitive about it, they say, you know what? hey, if you're making fun of it, it's okay. Make fun of it. Because people actually buy it too. And it's working. What it teaches us is if we can be proactively honest, if we can tell someone something we didn't have to tell them, but chose to anyway, we can build trust. This is not about admitting something the lawyers say you have to admit. This is not about putting the disclaimer on your stuff. This is about proactively telling someone, hey, you know what, maybe you might want to go with this instead of that, right? What happens when you go to the restaurant and the waiter says, you know, that one dish, I don't love the way the chef makes it. I actually prefer this one. And everyone who walks in, when they order that dish, they love it. What does that do to you? That makes you think, oh, you know what? Maybe I should go for this other dish because I trust that experience. Versus, you all know that waiter where you sit down, you're like, okay, so what's good? Well, I love everything on the menu. Everything's great. This is an awesome menu. And you're sitting there thinking, okay, that's useless. Thanks for nothing. You didn't help me out. You didn't help me decide. We don't believe that person, right? It's not as trustworthy. All right, second principle. How do we achieve relevance through purposeful storytelling? Through telling stories. You probably realized at this point, I love to tell stories. Stories are how we get points across. Stories are how we make things memorable for people. The problem is sometimes we call things stories that actually aren't stories at all. Here's an example. The State Bank of Purdy. Our story of First State Bank is that we were founded by so-and-so and so-and-so back in this day. Then we acquired this other bank for blah-de-blah billions of dollars. Then we moved from this location, which, by the way, was 50,000 square feet. Who cares? Does anyone care about any of these details of the story? No. What does the story actually look like? A story looks like this. It all started on a green couch. Mark spent long hours on this green couch, a hand-me-down from his big brother, talking to Dave by phone and planning the business. The more they worked at it, the more convinced they became that getting custom t-shirts the traditional way was a pain in the neck, and they started a business to make t-shirts. What could be a bigger commodity than that? Anyone can screen print a t-shirt, right? They chose to start a business doing this thing, but their story is we could do it better. And they carry that story through in everything they do. They have an entire page on their website talking about believing in the power of custom t-shirts. T-shirts can change the world. Now you might be sitting there thinking, that's a little bit too much for t-shirts. But if the people making the t-shirts can't get excited about them, that excited about them, then how can you expect anyone to, right? I want them to say that t-shirts can change the world. I want them to think that, because that's awesome, but they don't just do that. They do things that no other t-shirt company does. For example, they make Quidditch jerseys. Now, if you're unfamiliar with Quidditch, or it sounds familiar but you don't remember why, Quidditch is the fictional game played in Harry Potter, in the movies. And there are people on college campuses who play Quidditch, even though people can't fly. They run around with sticks, as if they're brooms, and then they throw the ball through the hole. Now, if you play Quidditch on a college campus, you're probably getting a pretty thick skin. You're probably used to being ridiculed, right? Because if you saw people playing Quidditch, you know what you would say. Even if you're trying to be kind, you know what you would think. But here's one company that says, you know what, we're not gonna make fun of you. In fact, by the way, since you're playing Quidditch, you probably need a jersey. And we're gonna be the number one world's biggest supplier of Quidditch jerseys. And they win. Because the story they're telling is whatever you wanna do, whatever you wanna love, we'll love it with you. And by the way, we'll make the t-shirt for you. Because when you love it with other people, you probably need a t-shirt. And it works, because of the story they tell. Another great example from a friend of mine who's a Hollywood producer, Peter Guber, and he put this story into his book, Tell to Win, which is all about storytelling. And the story was of an entrepreneur named Linda Resnick, the one who brought back Palm Wonderful Juice. And she's got tons and tons of money at this point. She can do whatever she wants. And there was a moment in time where she heard that the pearls that Jackie O wore, and all of the iconic pictures that were taken from US history, right, way back in the time, those actual pearls, the real life ones, were for sale at the auction. And she sent her guy, because she's a billionaire, she probably has an auction guy, right, so she sent her auction guy and said, go get those. And they started at $50,000, right? I mean, remember, these are iconic. Now, they weren't real pearls, by the way, because she wore fake pearls. So they're fake pearls, but, you know, they're the real ones that she wore. So you're with me so far, right? They're real, they're fake, but they're real. They're the ones she wore. So they're on auction. She sends her guy $50,000, puts his thing up, $100,000, thing up, $150,000, $200,000, still going. Eventually he buys them for just over $220,000 for fake pearls in the box. And then he brings them back to her. Now, she's a billionaire, right? Billionaires do weird things. Who cares? She has the money. But she's not buying it because she wants to satisfy some crazy urge to have these in a vault somewhere. No. She's buying them because she wants to create a replica and work with the Home Shopping Network and sell them. And she does. She creates a replica, and she sells the pearls with Jackie O's story for $150 on the Home Shopping Network, and she makes over $20 million. Did anyone that morning wake up thinking, wow, I need some fake pearls? No. They told the story of Jackie O. And the reason that resonated with people is because she was such an iconic part of American history. And could she have done this without having the real pearls? Sure. Would it have been authentic? No. But the one who has the real pearls, we imagine in our heads, oh, she could create the perfect replica. And of course, that's what she did. And by doing that, that story led to $20 million. Because people will buy it if it's authentic. If it's authentic. That's the key. So how do we create these stories to build an emotional connection? That's the secret there. Because we can't do it just by telling a story that's based on a fictional bird and expect it to work over time. But if we base it on something authentic, if we tell that real story, and there was a great example you saw, like some of the videos that John showed were perfect examples of bringing this to life, right? The Trading Places video, what a great example of that. Really bringing it to life, taking people behind the scenes. It's great. It's great stuff. Because you do amazing things. But people don't always see it, right? They see the end product. And if they don't see the other things, they don't have the reason to trust because they don't get the story. Third principle, how do we perform big and small acts of unselfishness? How do we focus on others instead of ourselves in what we do, in what we talk about? Who recognizes this? Raise your hand if you do. A couple people are with me. Okay, so this is a secret code that I used to use when I was a kid. And this secret code allowed you, in a game called Contra, to get 30 free lives instead of 3. If you pressed up, up, down, down, left, right, B, A, start, whoops. Go backwards, one more. Up, up, down, down, left, right, B, A, start. Before the credits, you got 30 lives. And by getting 30 lives, you could actually make it through this game. Now, the game developers for this game could have easily said, you know what, if you're not good enough, too bad. You're not gonna make it to the end. They didn't do that. They put a cheating code in. In fact, it's called the Konami code. They put the Konami code in because that was the maker of the game. So that kids like me could love this game because we would never get allowed to play long enough by our parents to get that good. The only people who could get that good were teenagers who had nothing else to do and could get away with it, right? And we were never in that category. But we were able to love this game because they were unselfish, because they put that secret code in, because they allowed us to love it. Now, here's the opposite of that. A form from BlackBerry. And ironically, this is a customer success story. So you can imagine how many of those they even have in the first place, right? And then in order to share my customer success story with them, I have to tell them, where do I work? How many people are in my workplace? Do I have a BlackBerry Enterprise server? How many people could I potentially have in my company that might want to switch over? What? Why? We see this all the time. You fill out an online form and they ask for your fax number. When's the last time you faxed something to someone? Is that not even necessary? Do you ask for people's home addresses when you're never gonna mail them anything? We see this all the time, and it's an example of selfish behavior. What it says is, oh, we have a database over here, and we need to fill in all of our fields. So we'll just put them all on the form, and you can fill them all out. And meanwhile, someone's sitting there trying to fill them out saying, what's the point? Why would I even bother with this? Instead, we need to take a stand for what we believe in. REI closes on Black Fridays. Why do they do that? They do that because they know that it's a statement of what they believe. They're being unselfish. They could sell more products if they were open, undeniably, right? Revenue-wise, of course they'd sell more stuff. They choose not to. They choose to take the hit. Weber Grills has done this for years and years and years. One of the biggest trends in marketing right now is content marketing. People say, oh, you should write content and put it online because it's better than ads. People will pay attention to it. Weber was doing content marketing way before anyone else, and they were doing it by publishing books. Back when I first got my house, I had a choice to make, and my choice was, what type of grill do I want to get? I never had enough space to have a grill, so all of a sudden I became a grill customer, and so of course I went online. And I realized that I had to make the religious choice, and the religious choice was gas grill or charcoal grill, right? And there's like big camps of people who believe in one or the other for home grilling. So I started to research it. I didn't know how to pick, but I found this one PDF. I still remember it, and it said, how to choose a grill. Perfect. And it was 7 pages, so I downloaded it, and I printed it, and I went through the whole PDF, and it gave me all the pros and cons. It said, oh, with the gas, it's like easier to start up, and with the charcoal, it's better flavor, and all of the stuff, right? And then I decided. I took that guide, and the last page of the guide was a checklist. And the checklist said, check off what's important to you. Okay, great. And then take it to your dealer, because people don't buy a grill online, right? It's a huge thing. So you research it online, and then you go into a local store. So I got my checklist, and I walked into the local store, and I gave it to the dealer, and I said, this is what I'm looking for. And he takes one look at that checklist, and he says, come on over here, sir. This is the grill you should buy. Why? Because Weber wrote the checklist, and so he sold me a Weber grill. That's how content marketing works. They could have, right, in that moment when I was searching, they could have said, we have this amazing new feature. It's a light that allows you to cook in the dark, so when it gets too dark, you just flip on the light, right? And they have all that stuff. Or they could have said, we have a summer special, $50 off, right? But none of that stuff matters because I don't even know if I want a charcoal grill or a gas grill. None of that stuff matters to me until I actually know what I'm looking for. And so you answer my question for what I'm looking for, then you're providing value. Then you're being unselfish. That's great marketing. And it worked. And I ended up with a charcoal grill, by the way, in case you were wondering. And I'm very happy with it. Honda did something similar. They sent out a whole team of people into Southern California, and they said, go off and just do nice things for people. Wear these blue shirts and buy people ice cream. Help them adopt a pet. Carry their groceries. Buy them gas. Pay for their parking. Think about the person who was sitting in front of the executive selling this program for a second. And that person has to explain the ROI of just sending their people out and spending time buying ice cream for people. How do you justify that? You're not seriously telling me that if I bought you ice cream, you'd come back and buy a car, right? That's not how car purchases work. But it raises the fundamental difference between marketing and sales. If you've ever been confused about the two, it's a perfect example, right? The job of marketing is not to sell a car. The job of marketing is to get people to the dealership. The job of sales is to sell the car when they're in the dealership. So by being out in the community and being part of the community, what they're trying to do is increase the likelihood that when someone is in the market for a car, they will come to the Honda dealership. They will consider a Honda. And in fact, that's what more people did. And they increased their visits to the dealership. Now, once you get to the dealership, there's a formula there, right? If you've ever worked in this or you've been a consumer of cars, you know. They get you in, they tell you about the deals, they want you to take a test drive because they know once you take that test drive, you're much more likely to buy a car, right? So it's all about getting people to the test drive. It's all conversion-based. You get 1,000 people in the door, you get 100 of them to do a test drive, you'll sell a car to, you know, 50% of them. I don't know what the math is, but imagine that's right. If you had 2,000 people in the door, you'd get more test drives and you'd convert more of those people. Now, if your conversion rate's going down, as salespeople, you have to figure out how to get it higher. That's a sales challenge. But marketing's job is to get them in the door in the first place. And that's why it works. That's why it works. That's the ROI. So if you're standing there and you're trying to decide on the ROI of a program, make sure you're comparing it to the right thing. Because if you were the leader sitting there evaluating this program, and that person was pitching the program to you, and they said, this is gonna be great, and you're thinking in your head, how is sending out people in a blue shirt to carry groceries going to sell cars? You would say no. You would decline that promotion, right? You'd say, I'm not wasting time and money on that, it's pointless. And you'd miss the opportunity. But if you said, would this get more people in the dealership? The answer might be yes. And then you might say yes. So we have to be open-minded enough to see how we're going to measure success, because it's not always the end game. It's something before the end game. Right. So how do we do these things and be unselfish? How do we take a stand? By having a point of view. How do we do it in a way that works? All right, fourth point. Focus on simplicity. How do we make things simpler? This will raise two ideas for people. Half of the crowd will say, that is awesome. I could have everything I could possibly even need in my pocket. And the other half will say, oh my God, that's disaster. But I want you to picture it mentally in your head. If you were to take all of these things that were open and close all of them, then I want you to picture that you were taking out the magnifying glass and you had to use it. How easy would that be to hold this thing, to use the magnifying glass? It doesn't actually become useful when you have too much stuff. It becomes too complicated, even though it seems, in theory, like it would be awesome to have something like that. This is one of my favorite apps, the Shazam app, because it only does one thing. If you're listening to music, and you hear the music, and you think, wow, that's a great song, you pull out the Shazam app, and you press one button, and it will listen to that song, and it will tell you what song it is. That's it. That is the most usable, easy, simple interface you could possibly have, and there's one big button, and it says, press me, and I'll tell you what the song is. That's it. That's the epitome of simplicity. This is the opposite of that. What we hear from airlines, right? We're improving the quality of our onboard product. All the language that's used in airlines is like the worst. It's like, look at that and do the opposite. Have you ever had that moment where the pilot says, we have a little bit of turbulence. We'd like the air cabin crew to get back to their jump seats. Jump seats? What? Where are they jumping? Are they leaving us? Why is it a jump seat? I don't have a jump seat. Do I have a jump seat? Can I use this cushion as a jump seat? What's a jump seat? And now we're panicking because of the language that they choose to use. It's idiotic. No one wants to hear that. We're improving the quality of our onboard product. What does that mean? Are you trying to make life better for us? We had a video one time where they talked about how good they were at moving cargo on a passenger flight where you already feel like cargo. Is that the video we want to hear about how awesome you are at moving cargo? No. We want to hear that you actually care about our comfort slightly. Tell us that. Give us that a little bit, at least. This was the original business plan for Southwest Airlines. Fly directly between three cities because that didn't exist at the time. That was it. And it works. I'm going to play you a short video that also focuses on simplicity, on something that many people would love to do, which is learn a new language, but don't often take the time to. And it's meant to motivate you, to show you how important it is to do a little bit of language learning.
Das hier ist mein Sektor.
Das hier ist das wichtigste Gerät des Küstenwächters.
Das Gerät und das Gerät.
Überlebensradar.
Hello. This is the German Coast Guard.
We are sinking. We're sinking.
What are you thinking about?
I kind of want to learn English now, or any language, right? Just to be able to know the little bit that will get me to that moment where I can help those people who are sinking. They're sinking. How do we make it visual, right? How do we make these ideas visual through simplicity so that people remember? They remember what we're trying to tell them, right? What's our cocktail napkin version of our business that we could tell to everyone on our team so that they would buy into it, so that they would know? And the last point is timing. How do we master the art of timing, putting something in front of someone at the right time, at the right moment. In the UK, Innocent Drinks is a smoothie brand, and on top of the smoothies, they have these little knitted caps that are knitted by elderly people, and it's all a charity. And if you buy one of these drinks with the cap on it, which is how they appear, by the way, at the point of sale, they have the little caps on them, and they're 50p, 50 pence extra. And that 50p goes to the charity if you buy the bottles with caps. It's a great way to bring the charity to life. It helps the bottle stand out, as you can imagine, in the retail store, and it works. It raises money for a great cause. On Twitter, Oreo's got great pickup by doing this on a regular basis. So they would use timing to focus on whatever was happening that day, and then they'd make it relevant to Oreos. Or flip around, they'd make Oreos relevant to that day, and it worked for them. Now, one of my favorite ideas that came from timing was, if you guys remember a couple years ago when Domino's did something really bold, right? They decided that they were going to revamp their pizza because they did all these focus group tests. And what people said is, your pizza crust tastes like cardboard and your sauce tastes like ketchup. And instead of trying to fix it in a small way, they said, we're gonna revamp our entire pizza. We're gonna make it awesome. And they did all of these things and they spent millions of dollars and they did all this advertising. And now imagine you're the little guy competing against Domino's, right? And they're spending multi-million dollars on all this campaign stuff, talking about how they're listening to their customers. And people are like, oh, I've never ordered Domino's, but maybe I will start ordering Domino's. Well, check out the timing and the beauty of this one billboard that this one small pizza shop put in to compete with Domino's. That's the power of perfect timing. You can deliver exactly the message you want to deliver in exactly the moment when it matters. And you can counter someone who has a much bigger budget, who's doing much bigger things, just by being a little bit more clever than they are. So how do we take this real-time nature? How do we be more flexible and take advantage of timing? That's the key. So if you've been looking at these five things, this is your secret formula. This is the one slide. This is the acronym, trust. How do we tell the unexpected truth? How do we deliver that to people in a way that's proactively honest so that they believe what we're telling them because we shared something we didn't have to? How do we achieve relevance through purposeful storytelling? We talked about storytelling, like what Linda Resnick did with the pearls to be able to sell $20 million worth. How do we be unselfish, like Honda was, or Weber Grills was, to focus on the other person instead of themselves? How do we engage simplicity, like the Shazam app, that one-button simplicity, the cocktail napkin, to be able to deliver something in a simple way? How do we get the right timing? How do we put it in front of someone the right way? So I want to leave you with one final story about putting all these pieces together to be trusted. And this final story is about the smartest man in the world, who many people consider him the smartest man in the world, who sold his biggest idea. Now, I'm talking about Einstein. Many people think is the smartest man in the world. And does anyone remember when he came up with his special theory of relativity? Does anyone remember what he was doing at the time? What was his job? Anyone remember the story? He was a patent clerk. He was a patent clerk. So I want you to think about that for a second. Someone comes along and has a theory that challenges everything everyone knows about established science at that time. And he's a patent clerk. And he publishes this story in a publication called the Annals der Physik in German. What would the reaction of the community be? Would it be option A, thank goodness this guy came along to tell us how wrong we've been for the last 20 years, let's all pay attention to him? Or option B, who are you to tell us what we're doing? You're just a patent clerk. Why should we even believe you anyway? We know what the reaction has been to people who had revolutionary ideas in science for years and years and years, right? They don't get appreciated, they become a laughing stock, they're undervalued, and finally, somehow, they're honored after they die. Why didn't that happen for Einstein? Why did people look at his theory and say, oh, we should pay attention to this, instead of laughing him out of the room? I mean, this guy's a patent clerk. What does he have that anyone should believe? Well, it turns out the underappreciated part of Einstein's story is who actually read his paper. There was one guy who read it. And that one guy's name was Max Planck. Max Planck was 20 years older than Einstein. Max Planck read this work and said, you know, there's something here. We should pay attention to this. Max Planck was the one who got Einstein his first professorship. Without Max Planck's support, Einstein never becomes Einstein. or at least not as quickly. My challenge to you is, who is your Max Planck? Who's the one who has to buy into what you're doing, who has to trust what you do so that you can achieve everything you want to achieve? Because it's not just about the product, it's not just about the story, and it's not just about being satisfactory. It takes more than that. It takes trust. That's the key. If we can be more trusted, we can navigate the believability gap, we can solve the problems that we're trying to solve, we can inspire more belief among the people that we're trying to reach. And that can lead us to success. So I'll leave you with one final slide, which is how to get in touch with me. If you appreciate new and interesting ideas, I do an email list that I send out every Thursday, and it's just the most interesting stories of the week, and that's the URL for how to sign up for it. I am absolutely thrilled that the lights did not go out, because they gave me that panic. Trust me, when you guys were out there and the lights went out, you were not as worried about it as I was. So I'm very happy that it lasted throughout. I have a lot of respect for what all of you do, and I was thrilled to be able to sit in the room and just appreciate it as a spectator. And I think this is a story, you all have a story that needs to be told. I get to be on a lot of stages, and I'm going to do my best to tell that story to more people because I've been inspired by this conference. I know you'll leave inspired by the conference as well. And I'm very thankful that I had a small part to play in it. So thank you for your time, thank you for your attention, and I'll hand it back to the team.
Thank you.